ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهد الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. أما بعد، اعلموا أن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Now, I was asked to speak about the importance of knowledge. And I need to clarify a few things before we start so we can understand where we're going with this thing. First of all, we have two types of knowledge. We have what is known as al-ilm al-nafi' wal-ilm al-dhahir. First category is the beneficial knowledge. Second category is the harmful knowledge. Now, can a knowledge be harmful? Absolutely. Because when it comes to knowledge, knowledge means anything that you learn. Anything that can harm you and it will not benefit your dunya or akhirah. So for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran about those who teach magic, يُعَلِّمُونَ النَّاسِ سِحْرًا. يُعَلِّمُونَ, I mean they teach people magic. So gaining the knowledge of magic, it's considered to be knowledge. It's considered to be something that a person can acquire, as a knowledge of information he can collect or she can collect. That we will not be talking about the harmful knowledge, because we all know this is not what we're here for. The second part is the part of beneficial knowledge. And this goes as A and B. One, A is the ilm al-deen, B is the ilm al-dunya. So A, knowledge of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. B is knowledge of this dunya. Not the deen, but dunya, the worldly thing. Learning that knowledge, as long as it's not part of the first category of knowledge, which was harmful knowledge, it could be mubah. It could also be an act of worship. For example, in the ummah, and by the way, I don't want to get into that, but it really can go to a different levels of mubah, levels of mustahab, levels of wajib, and so on. But just to touch upon this, in the Muslim community, we need to learn medicine so we can have medical doctors, we can have people who can treat our ill ones. We can learn engineering so we can teach, or we can build our centers, we can build our masjid. We need to learn nursing so we can have nurses who will also attend to those and mind those who are ill. We can learn any knowledge. And this is the idea of a mubah knowledge. But that knowledge, my dear brothers and sisters, can also turn into good deeds. How is that? Some of you may say, I'm doing engineering, I'm doing computer science, I'm doing, you know, this, I'm learning nursing. How could that be an ibadah, an act of worship? It can turn into act of worship if you turn and change your niyyah into a good deed. For example, if you say, I'm learning engineering, I'm studying engineering, but I want to benefit myself so I won't need people. I want to learn so I can get a decent job where I can earn my living, and therefore I can earn hasanat by donating to the people, by, you know, donating to the community, by, you know, taking care of my parents, by helping those who I need. Now that it turns into good deeds. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Mu'adh bin Jabal and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari to Al-Yaman, and he said to them, Tatawa, and this is what he said, Bashira wa la tunaffira, wa yassira wa la tu'assira. So he gave them three pairs of instructions. He said, Bashira wa la tunafira. He said, invite people to Islam. Do not, you know, hush them away. Don't be rigid and harsh. The people will walk away from the haq because of your attitude and because the way you delivered the truth. And then he says, second, make things simple and do not complicate. Some of us are very equipped in complicating things. Brother, if you don't do like this in salah, your salah is not accepted. Brother, if you hold your hand here, you're muftada. If you don't pray foot to foot, your salah is nullified. You know, these are important in salah, but the Messenger of Allah is that, yassira wa la tu'assira. Don't complicate. You know, I remember one of the brothers, we were in the state, and this brother, mashallah, he purposely and intentionally will wait until the imam says Allahu Akbar, and then he will walk through the rows of the musallim, and he will check if the pants is a little bit lower, and then he will go down and he will fold your pants for you in the salah. Now this is a little bit, you know, we're saying yes, we should do that, and we know what is necessary for us to do it regarding that. But a person, imagine you're trying to establish khushu' in the salah and someone playing with your feet, you know, folding your pants. Your khushu' is out of the window automatically. So the Messenger of Allah said, you know, yassira wa la tu'assira. Don't complicate things. Simplify the deen of Allah, because the deen of Allah is simple to follow. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa tatawa'a wa la takhtalifa. You know, be united in opinions and actions, and do not be different. Do not try to oppose one another. Do not try to object everything that has been said because you want to step up. And that's here was unique. Abu Musa would go elsewhere, and Mu'adh bin Jabal would go somewhere else to give da'wah, and they used to come together, and then they used to review what they did in those absences. Days when they absent from one another. And Mu'adh bin Jabal used to tell Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, قَالَ وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأَحْتَسِبُ نَوْمَتِي كَمَا أَحْتَسِبُ قَوْمَتِي. And this is what this is my shah. He said, Wallahi, I rely the hasanah that I gain for my sleep as I rely the hasanah that I gain when I do act of worship intentionally. Which means when he sleeps, he doesn't just sleep for 6 hours or for 8 hours just to sleep and enjoy himself. He will say with the intention, Ya Allah, I want to sleep so I can be strong giving da'wah tomorrow. So I can be strong teaching people. So those hours that he spent sleeping was considered to be an act of worship. So here, young lady and young men, young women and men, if you study school, you're in school and you say, I want to study engineering, I want to study science, I want to say public health, whatever course that you're taking, that means
and you say, I want to do it for the, my deen, for my ummah, that means you are mujahid fi sabilillah, because you're earning hasanat as you go to school. When they hand paper, you're earning hasanat because this is part of that. So let us not talk about that. Let us talk about the ilm of a shahid at this time, and then we go, inshallah, through some point. Now, ilm al-shahid also, it goes A and B. Ilm, which is must, far, and ilm, that is, you know, sunnah, and it is encouraged. Ilm that is must is a knowledge that pertains to your ibadah. Fiqh al-salah, fiqh al-siyam, fiqh al-zakah, if you have to pay zakah, fiqh al-hajj, if you go and you need to go to hajj. These are the fi'l that you must learn. You must learn before anything, before you study, you know, you listen to lectures before. And this is the ilm that is working upon you, and no one can ask you to not go there or study, and no one can stop you from learning that, because this is a farah. This is the ilm, farah. This is obligatory knowledge. In both ilm, when you're learning, this is what you need. First, you need ikhlas. You need sincerity. Allah said in the Quran, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. They were not commanded but to worship Allah with sincerity. Now imagine if one of the young men or young lady, she wants to study the deen of Allah, but she doesn't have that. Then whatever he or she is doing is pointless. Because in the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sahih al-Bukhari wa ghayrih, قال إنما الأعمال بالنية وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. He said indeed actions based on intention. Now Allah will reward you based on intention. So if this young man or this young lady wants to sit in the halaqah so she can learn and go and, you know, boast or, you know, boast for the other people and show that she or he knows better than the rest, this is Islamically not allowed. Why? Because in the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his son Ibn Majah, for Sahih al-Albani, he said the following. قَالَ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْعِلْمَ الْعُلَمَاءَ. He said, for anyone who learns this knowledge, so he can debate, he can respond to scholars, he can challenge his scholars, he can show off in front of the scholars. To overshadow those who are less knowledgeable than him. Or he wants to be in wujuh, or wujuh al-nas, or he wants attention from the people. I'm learning this. I want the people to know that I'm a knowledgeable person. I want people to know that I memorized the Holy Hadith. I want people to know I did this. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if this is the intention of that person, Allah will take you to Jahannam. Ya Allah, I'm learning the Quran. Ya Allah, I'm memorizing 40 hadith. Ya Allah, I'm doing this. Yes, you're going to take me to Jahannam. Yes, because he didn't do it for Allah, he did it for Rishi. And that is, by the way, remember the first three categories that Jahannam will stop you. A lot of you think, oh, the first one will be tossed into Jahannam and be Iblis, would be Abu Jahl, would be Abu Lahab, would be the people who are killing us left and right. Rather, the people who will be going to Jahannam first is someone who will learn this deen so he can gain respect of the people. And that's why Allah will say, I have taught you knowledge. What have you done with it? And the person will respond, Ya Allah, I read the Quran, I learned your Quran, and I taught it to the people. Ya Allah, I was a good teacher. Ya Allah, I gave so many lectures. Ya Allah, don't you? Did you see all my YouTube videos? You know, Ya Allah, I did a good job. And Allah said, No. You did this, hatta yuqal, so the people will say, he's a scholar. What must be the people say? So go to Jahannam. So be careful. So the first thing about Allah that we need to do is sincerity, is akhlaq. Imam al-Razi rahimahullah, Imam al-Razi rahimahullah, he used to say, من أشخص الله في قلبه, he said, whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens his heart to a hikmah because of sincerity, then Allah will open his tongue or his Allah is going to speak through wisdom and hikmah because of that. And Imam Khatib al-Baghdadi used to say, Al-Ikhlas lillah. He said, having ikhlas for Allah, having ikhlas for Allah, he said, it gives an understanding of the deen. If you have sincerity in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you understand this deen better. Ajib al-Ikhwati fi Allah. Imam ibn Taymiyyah, every time that he runs into a mas'al, every time he runs into a situation, he doesn't know what to do. كَانَ يُمَطْلِمْ جَلِيرَهُ عَلْمَقْ. He used to go down on his forehead and he used to make sujood and he used to make dua because he was sincere. Abu Salim bin Abdullah bin Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. He wrote to Umar bin Abdul Aziz and he said to him, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ عَرْوَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى لِلْعَبْدِ عَلَى قَدْرِ نِيَّتِهِ. عباد الله, listen to this. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ عَرْوَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى لِلْعَبْدِ عَلَى قَدْرِ نِيَّتِهِ. He said that the aid of Allah will come to the servant of Allah based on his intention. SubhanAllah. He said the aid of Allah, the help of Allah will come to the servant of Allah based on his or her intention. Which means if your intention is bad, then the aid and the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not come to you. So the first thing that about Allah that you want to do if you want to learn this deen is to have sincerity. Second thing is the taqwa of Allah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. Allah said in the Quran, have the fear of Allah and Allah will teach you. There's a connection between the two. If you have the taqwa of Allah, if you say to yourself, I'm learning this, how is this ayah or this hadith or this knowledge is going to bring me closer to Allah? If you have that intention, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the gate of ilm for you. You're not listening. Pay attention to this. If you want Allah to teach you, have the taqwa of Allah. If you want knowledge of Allah, then have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن تَتَّقُوا اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ فُرْقًا. He said, O people who you believe, if you have the fear of Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you a furqan, the understanding and opening of the gates of heaven. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged us to learn as Shaykh al-Malik Hasan bin Hadith and Ibn Abi Ta'ala al-Masur. Third thing that you need as a student of knowledge is a sabr, wal tahammul, wal ijtihad. The third thing that most of us don't have is having sabr in seeking knowledge. Let me ask you guys, why do you think we only have few scholars and we have hundreds of thousands in every city, every country who are ignorant? Why? Why do you think in a Muslim community you can find 10 to 15 doctors, medical doctors, in a small community? You may even find 50 to 60 PhD holders, but you cannot find one or two people who finish Islamic education. Why? Lack of taqwa and lack of salt. So this deen, ibadallah, is not given to everyone. Some of them, you know, two kinds of people. People will gain the knowledge of Allah, and they will be thrown to Jannah. نسأل الله أن يجعلنا منهم. And others, they will gain the knowledge of Allah and they will benefit, but they are few. Why do you think we have so many engineers, so many doctors, so many PhD holders, so many nurses, so many teachers, and so on, but you don't have enough ulama and engineers? We don't have so many. We have so many, yes. When you become a doctor, you look at the other side and say, if I become a doctor, I'm going to make this amount of money. If I become an engineer, I'm going to be making this amount of money. But when it comes to deen, dunya is not a priority. And that's why Allah does not give this to everyone. I remember first year of university, first day of university, first class of university, I walked into the Islamic University and Sheikh Rashid Al-Abwan, the same imam, he said to us, he sat down and said, Inna alhamdulillah, and he finished the Quran al-Hajj, and he said, I'm going to give you a nasiha. If you want to learn this deen, then you must have sabr. Al-ilm, sabr. Al-mubadis, sabr. Al-mada, sabr. Al-zameen, was sabr. Al-waqt. Khams, he said, if you have these five things, you will succeed. This is Rashid Al-Anwar, and I still remember. First class, first day, first hour. He says, if you want to learn this deen, you must have sabr al-ilm. Have that sabr. Because this ilm will not give itself to you. You really have to strive for ilm to give a drop of itself to you. He says, second, you have to have sabr with your teacher. Because some of the teachers are not eloquent enough to entertain you. And when you sit there and you get bored, like myself right now, I'm teaching a hadith and I was like, what the hell is he going to finish? You get bored because some of the ulama, some of the da'is, some of the teachers, they're not eloquent enough to deliver that knowledge to you. One of the most powerful ulama that you will ever listen to, Allah, in our century, was Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah. Sheikh bin Baz, when he's speaking, when he's talking, you can hardly understand unless you read it from Khalifa from Saudi. And he wasn't a person who would entertain you like Ali Abdul Khalid al-Qadi, or like Muhammad al-Iyani, or Muhammad al-Hassan. He was someone who, when you listen, you're like, unless you're a student of knowledge. Because the man was a mountain of knowledge and taqwa subhanahu. So the Sheikh, our Sheikh was saying, Rashid Al-Aman, you have to have sabr with the Sheikh, with your teacher. And you have to have sabr, have that patience with the subject that you're going to learn. Because some of you, and I know, you start with kitab, 40 hadith, and before you finish the third hadith, you want to go and study Bukhari. You start memorizing the Quran, and before you finish this Ammah, you're like, I want to memorize Surah Yasin. And the Sheikh said, no, you got to learn, you have to have sabr. Start from Alif, finish with Ya. As-sabr al-Nar. He said, as-sabr al-Zaleem. You have to have sabr with your classmates. Because some of your classmates, every single time, what did the Sheikh say? What did he say? Can I borrow your notes? You know, what can you give me? Let me copy. He said, you have to have sabr because they were also irritable. And then he said, as-sabr al-waqt. As-sabr al-waqt. Why? Because if you think you're going to sit in a lecture, or you're going to sit in a halaqah, or you're going to sit in a class for a year, and mashallah, you're going to say, I'm a teacher or I'm a scholar, you're wrong. That's not how it works. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal قال من المحبر إلى المقبرة. Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Ahmad ibn Sunnah wal Jama'ah, he used من المحبر إلى المقبرة. He said, how can you take my nose until I go to my grave? And this is when a student of his, he says, he saw Ahmad ibn Hanbal writing everything that he writes, and he said, yeah, Imam, I'm the Imam, you are our Sheikh. You're Imam Ahmad ibn Sunnah wal Jama'ah. You're Ahmed bin Hanbal. Why are you taking notes? قال لا مع المحبر إلى المحبر. I'll be taking notes until I go to my mind. So you don't say I learned 5 years, 6 years. Yes, no. What you learn is nothing but the keys of knowledge. Number four, ya ibad Allah. That you need, and I can see, mashallah, this is applies for you. Perfect. Number four is al-hifz. Al-hifz, memorizing the material. And I can see no one staring your pen. No one's other than see. A'lamna, mashallah. The biggest sheikh in the city is the only one who's taking notes. And this is Sheikh Al-Hamdan. He's the only one who's taking notes. And I'm sure, I guarantee, you know, him and Sheikh Mahdi, they are the most honorable people among us. But we don't take notes. We have, we're all like Imam Bukhari, and then Imam Shafi, and the rest, we hear one's case and we memorize. But al-ilm ya ibadallah is not what you hear, is how much you memorize. What is the difference between you? Like, what is the difference between Sheikh Hanbali and myself, simple man, and Sheikh Hanbali and man? This is the difference. If someone asks you, what is the hukm of salah? I would say the hukm of salah is fard. Because I'm an alim, I'm a simple man. But he will tell us, Allah said in the Quran this about salah. The Messenger of Allah said this about the salah. And the ulama said this about the salah. Therefore, I conclude that salah is fard. This is the response of the alim. وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ آيَةُ الْقُرْآنِ بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ And then he mentioned the salah. And then he mentioned the Aqwal ulama. And then he concluded. See, that is a student of knowledge. Why? Because he memorized. He is not an Ami who will say, oh, salah is fard. That is the attitude of Ami. Abdul Razak al-Razak, Ahad al-Ulama, meaning this is a mountain. If you don't know, this is one of the Imams of Ahad al-Hadith. And he used to say, كل علم لا يدخل مع صاحبه إلى الحمام فلا تبده علما. SubhanAllah. He said, any knowledge that doesn't go into the washing, do not consider knowledge. What does it mean? You're not allowed to take Quran into the washing, are you? No. You're not allowed to take a hadith in the Quran, in the washing. No. So, and you're not allowed to take anything that has the name of Allah in the Quran. So what is he telling you? He's telling you, if your ilm cannot go with you to the washroom where it's haram for you to mention the name of Allah, the name of the Messenger of Allah, the hadith, he said, if you can't take your knowledge to the washroom, you have no knowledge. كل علم لا يدخل مع صاحبه إلى فلا any knowledge that you can't take it to the washroom, it is not knowledge. Which means any ilm that you did not memorize, it does not consider to be a knowledge. And last night, you know, and last night, قال كل علم نفس الشيء لا يدخل معي الحمد فليس العلم. Any ilm that I cannot take it to the washroom, I wouldn't consider to be ilm. الخامس يا عباد الله. Fifth thing, learning is deep knowledge. If you want to become a student of knowledge, number five. Al-adab qabla al-talab. Al-adab qabla al-talab. You must have etiquette of students of knowledge before you become a student of knowledge. You better have the manners, the demeanor of a student of knowledge before you start seeking knowledge. When I was telling them, I'll tell you an incident. One of the first adab that we should have is having respect for your sheikh. One of the first thing that you should have is having respect for your sheikh. I remember, and I always mention this because it really affected me so much. When I went to university, we had sheikh The Sudanese Sheikh, well respected Sheikh by the name Sheikh Ja'far Sheikh Idris. Ja'far Sheikh Idris. He's a Sudanese Sheikh, he's a senior Sheikh, but he was very humble. And every day, every Friday, he used to invite his students to his house and he used to make food for us, especially Sudanese soup. It was beautiful. So every night we go forever, we go for the soup of my opinion. I was a priority, end my second. So one day, subhanAllah, I came to the university and I had another sheikh. His name was Hussein Shawab. He was a Tunisian sheikh and he was very hot. Not like Sheikh Ja'far Idris. So I went to him and I said, Diktor, Abdullah Sheikh bin Ja'far Idris said such and such. And the sheikh, Allah, his back was to me. I walked into the office and he was carrying books. And he was moving books from here to another shelf. So he had a number of books. And he lit the books. And I said, Ja'far, it is only this and this. And he dropped the books. And he hit the table so hard. Boom! And then he turned to me. And he said, what did you say? I did not do anything wrong. I said, Ja'far Idris. He said, in the fucking way, he said, do you think it's one of your boys? You know, how dare you say Ja'far Sheikh Idris? How dare you? Why didn't you say Diktor al-Diktor Sheikh Ja'far Sheikh Idris? And he gave me almost 10 million. Not nice lecture. He really scolded me and he showed me how idiot I was. How uneducated I was. How disrespectful I was. And all I did was, I just turned, I didn't even say salamu alaykum, and I walked away. Yes, I was embarrassed, I was hurt because you know, he didn't say a lot of nice things about me or to me. But I learned my lesson. And this is the first thing that you should do. Respect the adab, the first adab, have manners with your sheikh. This is before anything. You listen to the ulama, Abdullah ibn Mubarak radiallahu anhu wa rahim, قال طلبت العلم 30 سنة. He said, I sought علم for 30 years. وطلبت القرآن طلبت الأدب 30 سنة. He said, for 30 years I was learning Arabic, manners, for 30 years. وطلبت العلم 20 سنة. So which one is more? Look, he said, I was seeking manners for 30 years. And I was seeking knowledge for 20 years. So we have a lot of students, a lot of young people who have no respect for their local shiur. They have no manners. And they say, Sheikh, come here. You know. They have no etiquette. And unfortunately, this is one of the downfall of especially Ahlul Sunnah. They have no respect for their teachers. Ibrahim ibn Habib, al-Shahid, rahimahullah, qala li abi, ya bunay, go to the fuqaha. والعلماء سيكون القرآن العلماء وتعلم منهم and learn from them وخذ من أدبهم and learn their etiquette وأخلاقهم and their manners وهديهم and their way of life فإن ذاك أحب إلي لك من كثير من حديث. He said, you know, you're learning that, I prefer you learn those three things than you coming back with so much hadith and ilm. I don't want you to have so much ilm, so much knowledge, but no adab, no manners. Ibadallah. I can talk and talk and talk, and I think I'm running out of time. How much is that? Okay, this is our 20 minutes. Let's go with number six then. So I'm summarizing this. Point number six, Al-ilm bil-amal. Our ta'allum bil-amal. Al-ta'allum bil-amal. You learn by acting. You learn by acting. Majority of you, you know what is haram, what is halal. You know what is like and what is bad. You know the sunnah from the bid'ah. You know what is good and what is bad. We have knowledge, but we don't have action. And this is the worst thing that's happened to the ummah. Because the day that you do this, you will fall under the anger of the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah does not like that. Allah said in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَا تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَن تَقُولُوا مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. Allah said, oh, who you believe, why would you say that which you will not act upon? Why would you say that thing that you will not perform? Why would you speak of something that you will not do? How dare you say something but not carry on? Allah hates for you to say something that you're not going to do and act upon. So the first and the most important thing is you learn to act. You don't learn to collect. There's a difference between you collecting information and you learning to so you can act on. The ulama of the Salaf, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Shafi'i, and before them, they used to learn so they can act on. Sufyan al-Thawri, his mother used to say, my son, any knowledge that will not bring you closer to Allah is a harmful knowledge. Any ilm, la yuqarribuka ila Allah, fa huwa ilmullah. Any knowledge that you learn that will not bring you to Allah is a harmful knowledge. Stay away from it. And in the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Surah Al-Tirmidhi wa ghayri, Sanad al-Hasan, يقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تزول قدر عقل العبد يوم القيام حتى يسأل عن أربع. He said, your feet will not be moved on the day of يوم القيام until you are asked for four things. One of those four things, قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وعن علمه ماذا عمل and the knowledge that was given to you, what did you do then? Now, how many of you collect knowledge? How many of us collect knowledge today here? The question is, what did you do with the ilm, or what are you going to do with the ilm that you're going to learn today? قال الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله كنا نستعين على حفظ الحديث بالعمل به كنا نستعين حفظ الحديث بالعمل به. He said we used to seek memorizing the hadith through action, acting on that hadith. Through acting on that hadith. Because if you learn hadith and you don't act on it, you will not remember it much. So he said we used to act on that hadith and that will aid and help us to memorize the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Point number seven. The methodology of seeking knowledge. You just don't go and seek knowledge. There must be steps, there must be methodology. Right now, let me see, you know, if one of you wants to go to a medical school, do you start from the fourth year? Or there are many steps that you go on? There are subjects and courses that you gotta take before you take the next course. If you're in school, and especially in high school, for example, you don't take, you know, in a math, heavy math, before you learn how to add and do the other division and so on. Here is the same thing. You just can't learn, you know, the end. You don't learn the highest level of end without building your foundation of the end. So we will go, yes. The first nasiha that we have, that I will give it to you today is, you really have very short time for you to learn so much. So use your time wisely. That's number one.
Number two, learn that which is most important before you learn that which is important.
Learn priorities before you go that which is less priority.
Number three, you must have a written steps to follow, a method to follow, a methodology to follow. Number four, you start with واجبات العلم قبل الآن. You learn what is necessary for you to learn before you learn the tools of how to go one step out. طيب. This explains. We have in the Sharia, we have علوم أصلية وعلوم فرعية أو ثانوية. So you gotta learn علوم أصلية before the فرعية والثانوية. For example, for علوم الأصلية is the normalization of Qur'an. So that's the first. If you want to be a student of knowledge, you learn to normalize the Qur'an. يقال some of the narration that Imam al-Shafi'i was a nabi, he was a genius. He went to Imam Malik to study hadith under him. وكان عمره, and he was a very young man, they say less than 9 years, around 9 years old. So he went to Imam Malik and he said, I want to learn al-muwatta from you. قال Imam Malik, first call normalize the Qur'an. It's the first. He said, I already memorized the Quran. He said, then go memorize my book before I give you the explanation of a book. He said, now I already memorized a book. The point that I'm trying to tell you is, Imam Malik, he did not say, oh, you want to learn the book? MashaAllah, this is the book that I author, this is the book that I written. Come on, sit. But he said, no, go first learn the Quran and then come and learn the Hadith. Here it's the same thing. If you want to become a student of knowledge, learn the Quran first because that is the priority. When you learn the Quran first, then you come. Now we have many people and young ladies, they want to quote Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, Sheikh Ibn Baz, and Ibn Baz said about this, and this Sheikh said about that, Sheikh Rabi' al-Madkhali said about this, and they go here and there, and they don't even know how to recite the Fatiha and the Tajweed.
I met this young man, he was a young man, he was, you know, nowadays everybody's young. But he was almost 30. So I said, Yahya, before you tell me who refuted who and who responded to who, let me test your Quran. He said, ask me anything. I don't mind, mashallah. After that, I had a hadith of Rashid. I said, mashallah, you're talking about the ulama and you only have had a hadith of Rashid? I said, okay, you said Surah al-Nasr, إِلَىٰ جَعَلَ رَسُولُ. And he finished, I said, yeah, you're 30 years old, and you're talking about he is not from Ahlul Sunnah, and he is Mu'tadid, and this sheikh said this, and this sheikh is wrong. And you made 6 mistakes in Surah إِلَىٰ جَعَلَ رَسُولُ. You made 6 mistakes. And he wants to become a khatib, and he wants to give a khutbah in the masjid. So, before you start going to the ulama, which is not even furu', not even these are not even, you know, branch of knowledge, these are leaves of knowledge, not the fruit, because later you will learn who to go and who is the can take any from. So, hifz al Quran is must. Now, tafsir of the Quran, if you want to memorize it, there's of course, when you finish the Quran, you go tafsir based on the single tafsir of understanding of the Quran, like tafsir of Sirja Rahimahullah, and other tafsir, then at the end you end up inshallah, tafsir of Makathir and so on. The second asr that you must do is the aqeedah. Don't go to Siyah, don't go to Hadith, don't go to anywhere, aqeedah. And aqeedah, by the way, my dear brothers and sisters, is not for you to know al usul al balagha, the 3 fundamentals of Islam. It's not for you to know Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, Tawheed al-Rububiyya, or Tawheed al-Asma' wa Sifat. Aqeedah is by far deeper than that. And the university, for those, and of course the Shia, they understand, for those of you who did not go to Islamic university, the first year you learn Aqidah 101. The last year you learn Aqidah, you know, Aqidah al-Mustawa al-Khamis, the fifth level. So you don't only learn al-Usul al-Thalatha, al-Wahid al-Tawheed, but you learn deep Aqidah. You learn, you know, al-Firq. This firqa, they have this and this, and we differ with them because we have this and this. This majmur, they are the closest firqa to us, but we don't agree in this and this. And later on, when you're teaching them, you will learn how to refute, you will learn how to respond, and you will learn how to deal with them. Now, when you finish aqidah, and of course, kutub al-aqidah, there are simple kutub al-aqidah, and there are kutub al-aqidah that is, you know, thick and heavy. So of course you go with Usul al-Thalatha, and then you go with Kitab al-Tawheed, then you go with Aqidah, bit by bit, bi-ilahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then you will learn how to go with Aqidah al-Muriyah at the end of your journey. And by the way, Aqidah al-Muriyah is one of the most difficult Aqidah. And they used to teach us Aqidah at the end of our education system. Thirdly, given the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But hadith of the Nabi, you start with 40 al-Nawa. You don't go to, unless you learn ilm al-Ala, which is later on, you don't go to al-Tirmidhi. I'm sorry, you don't go to al-Sunan Abi Dawud. But you go to 40 al-Nawa. You finish that, then you go to Riyadh al-Salihin. You finish that, then you go to Jami' al-Ulum al-Hikam, which is 40 al-Shahr al-Ba'in, and you go Umdat al-Ahkam and so on, bit by bit until you go to Bukhari, Muslim and so on, and that's Ahlus Sunnah. Fourth is al-Fiqh, ilm al-Fiqh. And al-Fiqh, when you're learning Fiqh, you don't go Fiqh al-Mu'ah, you don't go to al-Muhri. You throw yourself and you say, al-Hanafiyyah, they said this, al-Malikiyyah, they said this, al-Shafi'iyyah, they said this, al-Hanabiyyah, they said this. And you think, mashallah, you know everything. No, you take one step at a time. You take the beginning of the end. One, depends if you follow a certain method, if you follow a certain group, you take one step at a time. And then, of course, you go with your teacher. This is called ulum al-asliyyah. Ulum al-musahil al-wathani, of course, is usul al-fiqh, then and so on. I think my time is up. I will stop here. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.